pain, sweat, and determination. This is the true story of British handball. Among the sports on view at next year's London Olympics, handball, a game that is not one of the nation's crown jewels. So the British have embarked on a promotional campaign. Here, a handball exhibition is taking place at St Pancras train station with its 120,000 daily visitors. The goal, to make the Brits familiar with the game of handball, and Kieran Williams, a member of the team, is acting as salesman.
Excuse me, do you have a moment? Can you tell me what sport this ball's used in? Football? No.
Soccer?
No. Have you heard of... Yes, handball. Have you heard of handball?
No.
You've not heard of handball? Okay. Go along here and you can have a go at throwing it with some of the Great Britain team. See how hard you can throw it? Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
In the UK, the word handball normally demotes a foul in football. Some 2 million people play football in Britain, but only a handful play the game of handball.
In the UK, there's probably about 1,000 registered players, but there's probably in schools about 80,000 children playing handball on a regular basis. And there's probably recreationally in clubs, maybe about 15,000 people playing handball.
Tom O'Branigan is the voice of handball in English-speaking countries. A former player himself, he's now TV presenter and commentates on Champions League matches. His biggest problem is that people don't even know what the game of handball looks like.
It's very difficult to explain to people. Sometimes we say it's a cross between soccer with your hand and basketball, which is not quite true. But when you're trying to explain to people, because they say, oh, you hit the ball over the net, and you say, no, that's volleyball. They say, oh, you throw the ball into the hoop, and you say, no, that's basketball. And
why is handball not more famous in the UK, though? Nobody really knows. Theoretically, the sport should suit the British mentality.
We like the contact, we like the physicality, we like the speed, we like the goals, we like everything. Everybody, when they play the sport, loves it. They absolutely love it. If a teacher introduces it in school, for the next year, all they get is, we want to play more handball. The kids love it because it's very easy to play, to start.
But in the UK, there are no professional clubs, no league, only an amateur cup. Nevertheless, Great Britain, as host of the 2012 Games, was naturally keen to take part in the Olympic handball competition. That's why a major project was launched in 2007 in order to build a squad. And they tried everything to discover potential players. They even advertised for them.
It was on the BBC website. I was actually currently working in London, and I just read that they were going to have athletes in every sport, including the minor sports like volleyball and handball. So it got me interested, and I contacted them.
Cipriotto has a French father, but his mother is English, and after a number of trials, he was selected for the British team. Back in 2007, he was working in insurance, so he had to make a choice, dedicate himself to his job or the forthcoming Olympic Games.
The main point that came across from everyone was insurance will be there the rest of my life until I'm 60 years old, and the Olympics only comes once, so that was the reason.
So Seb chose handball, even though his income was heavily reduced. He joined all the fresh handball recruits at a training camp in Denmark. Most of them were amateur players with dual nationality, like Seb. Or British athletes from other sports.
We were all pretty similar level, and I'd say we weren't at the best level at that time. But we had a lot more ambition than most people at the academy that weren't part of the project. So whenever they went out to party, then we were just thinking a bit more about it. Or whenever we went to watch a handball game at high level, we wouldn't be spectating. We'd be analysing the game and just learning all the time. And this is why we've improved so fast.
But after Beijing 2008, cuts in funding forced the players to leave their academy in Denmark. And in order to stay in touch with handball, they spread out to join clubs across Europe.
We had to make some hard choices. So the players were fantastic. They went to clubs in Europe. We had six players who went to Essen in Germany. They stayed in a two-bedroom apartment. for half a year. This is amazing what these athletes have done. You know, sharing rooms for periods, sleeping on floors and everything else. So the players have had to do a lot of sacrifices.
The players only get together for 60 days a year, and so far they've played a total of only 30 international matches. Since 2009, they've worked with a Serbian coach, Dragan Djukic, a man who's used to challenges. He's previously coached the national teams of Jordan and Macedonia.
My handball career always was connected with the challenges, and maybe this is the biggest one in my life because we create a new tradition, we create a completely new team, and I hope that something will stay behind us, some new fire here on the island for the handball, and that makes me proud, really.
Well, after back-to-back heavy losses at the start, the squad has improved, gaining in stability and team spirit. But it took 3.5 years for the team to celebrate its first ever victory in an international match. That was in June 2010 against Bulgaria. The score, 33-32.
We didn't have any professional players in the team. No players with professional or semi-professional contracts. And now we have many players who started in Britain and they've gone to other more established handball countries and they've got contracts. Maybe 5-6 years ago this wouldn't have been possible, and a lot of people said it would never be possible, you know, but we always believe, we still believe that, you know, we're on track and we're on the right course to be competitive at 2012.
After all the sacrifices and all the work they've put in, the players hope they'll now be able to use the Olympics on home soil to really launch the sport in the United Kingdom.
It's the biggest sporting event in the world, you know. It's almost like, you know, it's the best shop window in the world for everybody who, you know, hasn't seen it before to see the sport, to experience it live and to see how it's played on the highest level.
It was in Sydney, it was voted the most interesting sport, and they didn't know what handball was either, and then everyone just started to get interested in handball, and this is what we're hoping as well.
So Britain are in the same situation as the Australians were at the Sydney Olympics. The Aussie team was created especially for those games in a country with absolutely no handball tradition. The Australians finished 12th out of 12. 11 years later, that team still exists with a new generation of players. Since 2003, they've competed at every World Championship, but they have yet to qualify for another Olympic Games. Some of the Aussies play in Europe nowadays, like Bevan Calvert. Back in 2000, he was only 14 and watched the games on television.
It was a very popular sport. It was sold out every game, and when people didn't understand, the commentators made it quite easy for the people to follow. And we had a lot of inquiries of how people could get involved in the sport, how they could play, where the sport is offered. And yeah, unfortunately, we didn't capitalize on the fallout after the Olympic Games. They didn't have quite the numbers to help support all the people asking. So hopefully we can get another Olympic Games and get all those people back in.
Yes, the games changed virtually nothing for Australian handball. Today, no more than 1,000 people play the sport across the entire country. Almost all the national players are amateurs, and they have to pay for their own travel expenses when they compete.
Because we love the sport, and it's not anything for fame or for money. There's none of that in Australia. And the organization, we're trying to promote it a bit more, get more people involved. But as it stands now, we don't have many officials, and players are always self-funding the sport.
Bevan plays for TSV Altenholz, a second division team in the north of Germany, close to the Danish border. He's only semi-professional and has to work as a fitness teacher to supplement his income.
Definitely. I'll be playing this game until I can't walk anymore.
It's brought me so many things that I wouldn't have expected. I'm living in Europe now. I love everything about the sport, and I'm hoping that I can give back as well, and I'll give my experience onto the new generation of handballers, and it's definitely within in my future. It's been an important part of my life now, and I'm not going to give that up.
Bevan Calvert's experience is valuable. That's why he met the British team, to share his knowledge with them and help them to avoid making the same mistakes.
He explained some people were phoning up and they were told the nearest club is 150 kilometers away from. So that's why they just, okay, I won't bother trying this sport. But in Britain, we've got clubs that are nearer, and also just the country's smaller than Australia. So I think we are more ready than them. And this, we had this speak with him in 2006, so he has warned us.
On the question of probable British results at the forthcoming Olympics, opinions are mixed.
We have a big ambition to be a top eight.
If there are eight teams in the Olympics, it's a possible goal, yes.
I'm confident that we can do. I've been confident since 2006 that we'll do this. And I think everybody in the team is, and if we weren't, then we wouldn't be in the team.
But the real goal is beyond London 2012. The Games are supposed to represent not an end, but a beginning.
The idea is that we use London as a strong foundation to create a young team for men and women that then can go to try to get to Rio. But certainly by 2020, we want to have Great Britain teams playing at the Olympic Games.
You know, my dream is that in the next 10 years that we have a semi-professional or even professional league here and that I can come back and play here. That's my personal dream for the future.
From July the 29th next year in the Olympic Park, the Handball Arena will host 12 teams competing for the gold. The British squad are hoping that they'll do enough to persuade the people of Britain to take the game to their hearts.